Now back in section 3.2.1, when we first discussed creating elements, we discussed reference types, and that's because as we created elements, when we organized these elements into structures like this, where production line 1 is considered a parent element of these child elements, well, there is a need to define what the relationship is between this parent and this child, and we defined three different types in that video. Let me show you an example. Let's pretend I'm going to add a new mixing tank. If I choose a new child element, as you can see, there's three reference types we can choose from. Composition, which means it's essentially part of the parent. So if you delete the parent, it immediately deletes the child. There's the strong reference type, which we call parent-child. Strong reference type means that as long as one parent element refers to that child element, then we won't delete it. And then there was the weak reference type. And essentially, the weak reference type means that the parent really has very little relation at all with the child. So let's say, for example, you had one element that is the child of two parents. With one parent, it has a strong reference. With the other parent, it has a weak reference. Well, if you delete the parent that has the strong reference to that child, then we essentially will delete that child from underneath the parent that has the weak reference as well. So it's something we kind of clean up the orphan child elements that don't have any strong reference to the parents anymore. So that's what a weak reference is. Now don't worry if that discussion of strong, weak, and etc. in composition doesn't make any sense. We will go over this again as we now discuss the topic of creating your own reference types. Now I think it helps to explain reference types by going back to our original diagram here and really pointing out where on this diagram you would find a reference type. See, a reference type is not any one of these objects. This isn't a reference type, that's an element. Okay, these aren't reference types here. Reference types aren't objects. What they are they're kind of a status that is assigned to the relationship between an object and its parent object. So for example, this area 1 is a parent of this line A. And right now, if it's using the default, it's established what we're calling a strong reference, or the name we use is parent-child. Again, there's only three types of references. There's the composition, the strong, and the weak. The parent-child is also known as the strong. So that strong reference there means that it's only when all of the parents that have a strong reference have been deleted that we will do anything to this child reference here. So why is this worth talking about? Why even bother with these reference types? Why not just make them all the same? Well, with a hierarchy like this, especially when you're dealing with thousands or tens of thousands of units, you can very quickly get yourself into a situation in which you've got a lot of kind of orphan objects. Objects that just were added at one point and just nobody kept track of when they should have been deleted. So one of the best ways of handling that is to have some kind of a mechanism to establish exactly what is the relationship, what's the nature of the relationship between these objects right here. So for example, this object here, heat exchanger A, it has a relationship to this parent object called heat exchangers. That relationship right there, how you define it, that's really up to you. It can be composition, it can be strong, or it can be weak. Likewise, this heat exchanger A, which incidentally is exactly the same heat exchanger A that you see over here. These are identical objects. They're both the exact same element. They're just represented in two different places. That heat exchanger A has a relationship to line A. And you get to define what that relationship is. Is it a strong relationship? Is it a weak relationship? What it means, if for example, this were to be the weak relationship, this were to be the strong relationship, it means that if you were to delete, at this point, the parent of heat exchanger A here, then heat exchanger A would disappear in both places. And that's one of the benefits of establishing these reference types, is that you can define, you know, under what circumstances, when you delete a parent, are all instances of the child deleted. Now, there are other benefits to using these reference types that we're going to go over in just a bit. You can also use them for establishing exactly just what can be assembled if you'd like to put some limits on how you can put together these elements. And we'll look at that a little bit later on. And what we're going to do in this video is explain why would you ever want to create your own reference type? Why is just the composition, the weak and the strong, not enough? Why would you want to create more? Well, it's basically so that you can establish a reference type of your own that says, for example, when you're working with line B, the recommended link to a line is a heat exchanger. Or put it the other way, you could establish that this heat exchanger should always have a reference type that you're going to define as, oh, let's just call it the line A heat exchanger reference type. You want to define that specific reference type so that people know when they're dealing with a heat exchanger, that's what they're going to be connecting that to its parent with the line A heat exchanger reference type. So let's take a look at how we would do that. I'm going to go into my sample database here. And actually, I'm going to build a brand new database. Let's go into the database option. Let's do a brand new database. I'm going to call this my plant. Just to show you there's nothing that we've established in advance here. It's all going to be from scratch. Now, the example I'm going to be using comes from manufacturing and chemicals. I'm going to create a unit called sodium unit. We're going to be making sodium. We make sodium in these sodium cells. And I like using this example because the sodium cells in the instrumentation give you an example of why you might want to use weak references at times. So let's just describe these sodium cells. So imagine you've got a big tank in which you're going to be melting salt and extracting from it sodium and chlorine. And you don't just have one of these tanks. In these manufacturing facilities, you'll see hundreds of these things lined up. Oops. Let's say this is all stretching off into the distance here. We've got lots and lots of these sodium cells. Now, each one of these sodium cells has pieces of equipment attached to it that, for example, it's got a feed that brings in salt. It's got down at the bottom here, it's going to have a heat source. And on that heat source, we're going to have a temperature transmitter that we're going to be using to map what the temperature is. So we'll mark that as the temperature transmitter. And so we'll mark that as the temperature transmitter. In addition to that, there's also going to be something that measures the level. So we've got some kind of a level transmitter that we put up here. And the instrumentation on that, we'll just mark that as L for level. So that's the instrumentation we would have on the sodium cell. There'd be other things as well. And the point I wanted to make about this is these temperature transmitters, you know, once you put this into this sodium cell, and this thing's about, you know, it's about the size of a truck, and it gets extremely hot. Once you put these temperature transmitters in there and you start melting salt, that's about as good as they're ever going to do. That's a one-way trip. You really can't go in there and easily haul this thing out and put it somewhere else. And besides, the temperatures these things work at, you know, after a year or two, you go in there, you try to rip it out, it's basically going to fall apart in your hand. So you're not going to be able to recover this and put it anywhere else. This essentially is going to have a composition relationship to the sodium cell, because once it's in there for good. On the other hand, these level transmitters, this might be, you know, the latest ultrasonic level transmitter. You can take it. If it breaks, you can move it or put in a new one, no problem. Or more importantly, you can take this, and if you decommission the cell, you can take this level transmitter and move it somewhere else. So this would not have a composition relationship with the sodium cell. This would be more of a parent-child, or what we call a strong relationship. So as long as this level transmitter exists somewhere in the list of level transmitters, doesn't matter if we decommission this cell and delete it, we still want that around. So given that that's our situation, let's create a data structure that would support that, you know, having composition relationship for the temperature transmitter, but a strong relationship for the level transmitter. And while we're at it, let's also set this up to be a little easier for people so that they know when they're using one of these temperature transmitters or level transmitters that they're only supposed to use the reference types of temperature transmitters and level transmitters. We're going to create a new reference type. We'll call it cell to temperature transmitter, and another one called cell to level transmitter. And that, you know, those two reference types are the ones that people will be presented with when they have the option of creating a reference from a parent to a child. they will have that option to create that reference type.